فلك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى ترث الأرض ومن عليها أنت خير الوارثين. نويت تعلم وتعليم وتذكر وتذكير نفع انتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله بسنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ودعاء للهدى ودلالة على الخير ابتغاء وشلة ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. We're still looking at the life and times of the great Sayyidina Abu Bakr Abdullah ibn Uthman رضي الله تعالى عنه وأرضاه. And what we looked at in the end of the last session was the great wars that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda engaged in during his brief khilafah, the brief period in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him the vicegerency on behalf of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Now we made mention of that after the flight of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam unto Allah ta'ala, that the actual nature of Islam or the Muslims inside of Arabia becomes somewhat characterized by disequilibrium and turmoil. And this obviously is due to the first and last tragedy of the Muslims in the real sense, which is the actual death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. It renders the Muslims in a state of disequilibrium to the point that we're going to see that a great number of the Muslims, yani apostate in the eyes of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu from the actual religion of Islam. And it's on that basis Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda is going to unleash in various leaders of the Muslims, armies, onto the various regions of the actual Muslim world. And the Muslim world at that point in time is somewhat confined to the various tribes of inner and southern Arabia. So Abu Bakr, as we said, radiallahu anhu warda, is going to send armies to the Yemen. He's going to send armies to Hadramaut. He's going to send armies to Mahra. He's going to send armies to Amman. He's going to send armies to near Western Arabia, the Hijaz. He's going to send armies to the Najd. He's going to send armies to the Arud, Bahrain. He's going to send armies to Iraq. He's going to send armies to the Levant, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. For all intended purposes, the entire Khilafat of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, is characterized by war. Okay, which for many of us, when we try to sort of fathom and conjure up our impressions, that which maybe we engage from the various traditions of the Prophet ﷺ as it relates to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda, and we don't sort of any sense that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is an imam of war. Yeah, that is contrary to the truth, that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda is an imam of war, such that we know that the day after Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda enters into Khilafat, that he unleashes the great army of Sayyidina Usama ibn Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, an army that was 40,000 strong. This is like the first day after his inauguration, the day after he becomes the Khalifa of Ahlul Islam. And the day Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu dies, a letter reaches Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid in the Battle of Yarmouk, the great Battle of Yarmouk. And he dies while an army of 40,000, same number, is engaged in the might of the Romans, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. That's the day he dies. So we see from his first day to his last day, it's characterized by war. And we said that the initial wars were due to these false prophets, these former oracles of Arabia, like Al-Anasi, Al-Aswad Al-Anasi, inside of the Yemen, like Tulayha, who was from sort of the near Najd, we could say, or the near Hijaz. Likewise, also Musaylim al-Kadhab, who was obviously the greatest of all of the threats, the Prophet ﷺ called him al-Kadhab, the liar prophet. Someone who the Prophet ﷺ met in the wake state and saw in symbolic form inside of the dream state. And that becomes the greatest war inside of the time, life and times of the companions, greatest in terms of that which was the most difficult of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. And likewise also the battle against other sort of false claimants like Tulayha, he made mention of, and like Shujaha, also this woman, quote unquote, false prophetess who stoke a claim to prophecy. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, with the exception of the first, who was Al-Anasi in the Yemen, it's the armies of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that crushes all of those threats. And likewise also the armies of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that brings all of those Muslims who erroneously believed that the zakah was only due to the Prophet ﷺ and not due to anybody after the Prophet ﷺ. It's Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu corrects that mafhoom, corrects that misunderstanding of the religion. Khudh min amwalihim sadaqah. Allah Ta'ala says, take from their wealth sadaqah. And so maybe they erroneously understand khudh. It's singular in the Arabic language, so the commandment is only for the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You want to give people the benefit of the doubt. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was not about to give anybody the benefit of the doubt on such an important principle at such an important time inside of quote-unquote Islamic history. That what we take into consideration inside of the law is a general application of revelation and not the particular circumstances or unto whom those particular verses were revealed unto, like the Prophet ﷺ, as general application. And is zakah wajib ala al-kul, that is something which is obligatory for anybody who's beyond the threshold. On the basis of refusal, Abu Bakr unleashes armies to what is the, what we consider at that point in time, the Islamic world, which obviously is contained to Arabia at that point in time. And nobody who refuses zakah is spared. Those who don't or refuse to pay are going to be abased, and they're going to face the might of the armies of As-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wardah. They're going to be brought into check. And those who never refuse, when the armies arrive, they're going to be elevated by virtue of it. Like we see inside of the great city of Tarim. Because Hadramaut Kindah, in Hadramaut in the Yemen, was one of the places that rebelled against the authority of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And so Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wardah, he unleashes armies onto Hadramaut. And they travel from Medina to Hadramaut on horseback within a 2 week period. And wondrous how quickly they actually got to actually Hadramaut. And they find Hadramaut in rebellion against the actual authority of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. But when they reach the actual great city of Tarim that we hear much about, that they find that the people of Tarim are Musallameen, that they're of those who have not rebelled against his authority, and they're willingly paying the actual zakah in and of itself. And then the people of Tarim thereby begin to assist the armies of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu wa arda in terms of the various wars that they had against various elements of Kindah. Kindah is one of the ancient names for the actual valley of Hadramaut. Like when you hear somebody is called Al-Kindi, some of them we call Al-Kindi, like the greatest poet ever. His name is Imr al-Qais Al-Kindi. Imr al-Qais Al-Kindi, meaning he's Imr al-Qais of Hadramaut. His father was the actual king or the chief of Hadramaut, whose kingdom or whose realm was usurped. And he's famous as in fact is well known inside of the story of Imr al-Qais. Or likewise, they're also called Al-Hadrami. Sometimes you hear them called Al-Hadrami. Like one of the great and most eminent of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of the great generals of Abu Bakr's armies that he unleashes, Abu al-Ala al-Hadrami, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. Hadrami, he's the one who Abu Bakr unleashes upon the Bahrain. Who's going to ensure that Bahrain is brought into the what? Into line with paying the zakah, and then he's then going to be in charge with what? Initiating the first initial what? Wars against the actual Persians in and of themselves. And he's the one we hear in the great tradition of Sayyidina Abu Huraira, who's in the army of Sayyidina what? Sayyidina Abu Ala al-Hadrami, who speaks about all of the various what? The various miracles of Abu Ala al-Hadrami. Of the miracle that when we reach the great river, how do we cross? Abu al-Hadrami, Hadrami just alighted his horse, he prays to raka'ah to Allah Ta'ala, Abu Huraira anhu says, and then da'Allah. Then he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and calls upon Allah Ta'ala, Allahumma ya Allah, ya Aliyu, ya Azim, ya Halimu, ya Ali. He uses those five names which Imam Abu Hassan al-Shadali, radiallahu anhu warda, immortalizes inside of his Hizb al-Bahar. Imam Abu Hassan al-Shadali considered those five names to be Ismullah al-Azam. They're the names of Allah Ta'ala that if you use them inside of a dua, that your dua is answered. Atman. That's what the Prophet ﷺ called the Ismullah al-Azam. Imam Abu Hassan al-Shadi considered it to be those names that Imam Abu al-Hadrami, the great Hadrami Imam, called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by virtue of. You see the result of it, because when he alights his horse, he just tells the entire army, ride. And then they began to ride over the river, over the sea, they're all riding on horseback. Radiallahu anhum wa ardahum. Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says what? That the hooves of our horses never even got wet. And we would have an intimate conversation with each other as we rode over the ocean. Radiallahu anhu wa ardahum. Look at the Imams. You see, they fear Allah Ta'ala, so Allah Ta'ala subjugates the entire creation for them. Radiallahu anhu wa ardahum. He said on the second occasion, he said that we were in a state of dire thirst on these war missions on behalf of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So Abu al-Hadrami, rahimahullah ta'ala, that he just raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and calls upon Allah ta'ala. And he said, as he's praying, we see the clouds appear in the sky and rain begin to fall. And water fall for the actual companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who were engaged in a battle on behalf of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And they all drink, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa rada. And then the third, he said, I heard inside of a dua of saying Abu Allah al-Hadrami, that he was making Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, says that, oh Allah, yani when I die, allow nobody to locate my actual body. I want to disappear inside of the earth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he wanted to be somebody who was what? Yani in al-Islam bada al-ghariba wa sayyidu al-ghariba kama bada fatuba lil-gharaba. He wanted to be of those who considered to be from the strangers, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, not only strange upon earth, but strange inside of the barzakh. There were sahaba like that, like Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. Ya Abu Dharr, sata'ish wahidan wa tamut wahida. Like, oh Abu Dharr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you will live alone and die alone. Yani you're a loner in the barzakh. Loner inside of the world. Abu al-Hadrami desired that type of rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be alone inside of the barzakh radiallahu anhu, and nobody to locate my body. And he said, thereby we were gripped with intense thirst once again. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu wa arda says, and Abu al-Hadrami dies as a result of it, of that intense thirst, as they're on in missions on behalf of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. What did they do? They then said that we buried Sayyidina Abu al-Hadrami, we actually buried him, Abu Hurairah says, and then we actually covered him with dirt, but it was like a shallow grave. And wondering why, so we left, and then we said, no, we better go back to bury him what, further in the earth, in case what, like wild animals uproot yani the actual grave or uproot the body of Sayyidina Abu al-Hadrami. In another riwayah, one of the actual companions of Abu al-Hadrami had left one of his possessions beside his grave. Ala kulli hal, they returned back to where they buried Abu al-Hadrami. They said, like short while later, soon as they get back, that they noticed that the actual grave of Abu al-Hadrami, which he tried to exhume, has completely disappeared. And they dig and they dig, his body is gone. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ta'ala. Mustajaba to dua, very famous, and his dua was answered the great Imam of Hadramaut. When they reach Tareem, that they find Tareem is a place that is submitted completely to Sahaba. Radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. Bukind is in rebellion, Hadramaut is in rebellion. But the point is, they send a letter back to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq gives them the greatest gift anybody could ever want, desire. The dua of those whose dua, prayers, are maqbool and Allah Ta'ala, accepted with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for da'a li Tareem. That he made dua for Tareem for three things, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The first thing he made dua for, the city of Tareem, that it remains ma'mura ila yawm al-qiyamah. That it remains built, an established city, until the day of judgment. It's not destroyed. And if you understand Hadramaut, cities come and go inside of Hadramaut. One of the great Imams, the forefather of the Habaib, had Imam Muhajir Ahmed bin Isa radiallahu anhu warda, the place where he settled and died, which was a thriving city when he was alive, and it no longer exists whatsoever. It's gone. The city of Tareem, where it's to rain 1 month inside of Tareem, rain, you know, 1 month's rain in England, where it used to rain, where it's to rain like in England for 1 month, the entire city of Tareem would disappear. That's how fragile it is. Yeah, we see now 1500 years later, and khalas, Tareem is still there. Dua of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Ma'mura ila al-yawm al-qiyamah. And you want to know how truthful Abu Bakr is? You want to know how truthful, how his words is? Then you ask Allah Ta'ala in the barzakh, because inshallah Ta'ala we'll all be in the barzakh, ameen, at that point in time, that when the hour comes, just before the hour comes, ask Allah Ta'ala to show you Tareem. You'll still see Tareem ma'mura, is to be on the face of the earth, even at the end of time, the city of Tareem. That's the dua of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The second is that he said that Allah, he asked Allah Ta'ala to give Tareem water, make its water abundant. In the midst of the desert, saying Tareem is, and it's a place that not only has abundant water, but very sweet water. I met somebody who did a PhD, he's doing a PhD in water studies, very important at the end of time. The Prophet ﷺ said, the wars at the end of time are over water. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of the reasons, and you see that, he said in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Tamim al-Dari of the Antichrist of the Dajjal, and he concerned about water and the consumption of water, signs of his manifestations. And so what did this person, he made mention that when they studied the actual water table, the nature of water inside of Arabia, in Arabia studying water, that they find something pretty amazing in Arabia. What was that? That the water table beneath Arabia is on an incline and it inclines all towards Hadramaut. That when the water falls into Arabia, it just heads towards Hadramaut. And we could give you a more precise location, Tareem. And we can even tell you before the dua of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, it wasn't like that. That his dua changed the actual nation of the actual earth of Arabia and sent water towards Tareem. That's the dua of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's people. And the third, he says, he asked Allah ta'ala, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, to bring forth ulama from Tareem, the soil of Tareem, in the same way he brings forth vegetation from it. Look what we see Tareem. Look at the ulama that's produced. And when dakhala Tareem, kharaja saleem. Whoever enters Tareem, enters out in a state of what? Of safety, security, and what? And wholeness in terms of faith. That's the dua of Siddiq for those people who are in the obedience of Allah Ta'ala, His Rasul, and those who represent the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. But they were few and far between. The majority of those Arabs, those 43 or 45 different delegations that gave bay'ah to the Prophet ﷺ in the ninth year after Hijrah, majority of them, they reneged from the religion, but they were quickly brought back into line by the staunchness, and it was the staunchness of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu warda. But that's also going to present problems. And what's the problems it's going to present? Yani with war comes death, and especially because the people who are in war, yuhibbun al-maut, that they love death. And Sayyidina Khalid Walid radiallahu anhu warda, under the direction of Abu Bakr, engages the first war armies of Iraq from the Persians who were inside of Iraq. That's what Khalid told what the Iraqis, the Persians. And we'll see the same way he'll also tell the Romans, Khalid ibn Walid, in the beginning when they're trying to negotiate peace as opposed to war. Jittukum bi unasin, I came to you with people, yuhibbun al-maut, who love death. كَمَا تُحِبُّونَ الْحَيَاةِ, in the same way that you love life. In another riwayah, when he said to the Hayara, to the people of Iraq, يُحِبُّونَ الْمَوْتِ كَمَا تُحِبُّونَ شُرْبَ الْخَمَرِ, that they love death in the same way you love to get drunk and to drink wine. Sayyidina Khalid Walid would tell these opposing armies that these are people who love death. And so lo and behold, we're going to see a great number of them die. What's one of the problems that poses is that deen is in rijal. That the nature of religion, especially in that age, it was in those people who the Prophet ﷺ crafted. It is not fi butun al-kutub. It's not inside of books, but it was inside sudur al-rijal, inside of the hearts, the breasts of great men and great women. كان العلم في الصدور ثم انتقل إلى السطور ولكن الرجال بقوا مفاتيح العلم. That knowledge used to be in the breasts of men, and then it transferred onto the pages of books, but men remained the keys to that knowledge. That's one of the great statements the ulama make. We're going to see part of that transfer from Rijal to the pages of books in the life and times of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. And he's the great initiator, radiallahu ta'ala, anhu wa ardahu. Why? Because of the death of the companions themselves, radiallahu anhu wa ardahu. We discussed the battle of Yamama. That was Musaylim al-Kadhab, one of the greatest threats inside of the early war polity of Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. When somebody who tried to front upon the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sahibu sallam, calling himself Ar-Rahman al-Yamama, the Beneficent of Yamama. Until the might of Sayyidina Khalid Walid faces, who Musaylim al-Kadhab, and Musaylim al-Kadhab alongside a great number of those who were alongside him, was actually slain in one of the most difficult battles, the battle that the Sahaba ever engaged in. We look at some of the martyrs, because this leads on to part of our topic today. Look at the martyrs, those who died inside of the Battle of Yamama, some of them, and there were many who died, for amongst them Abu Dujana, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, warda, of the kibar of the companions.
Remember how great the people of Badr are. Remember how great the people of Uhud were. We see when Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib enters into the house of the Prophet and he takes his sword, which is dripping with blood, and he gives it to Sayyidina Fatima Zahra al-Batul radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha, requesting that she cleans the actual blood of his sword radiallahu anha. And he said, this sword did damage today, it did justice today. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu says, in the presence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, and so did the sword of Abu Dujana, and so did the sword of Zubayr ibn Awam radiallahu ta'ala anhuma wa arda. And this is Abu Dujana, the great Abu Dujana, the one at Uhud who wore the great sort of red imama, which was called the turban of death. Because everywhere you saw the turban of Abu Dujana, you see someone died beneath that turban at the hands of the great Abu Dujana. Why? Because he was carrying a sword, like a very, very special sword. And that was the sword of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he raises that sword at Uhud, who is going to give this sword its right? Who's going to give this sword its right? Sahaba desired, but Sahaba were fearful of, well, what is the right of the sword? Abu Dujana steps forth, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, what is the right of the sword? Tell me what the right of the sword is. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the right of this sword, and tuqatil bihi, that you fight with it, fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hatta tuqtal, until you're killed. Who would take that type of sword? That's the right of the sword. You have to use that sword till you die beneath it. You fight with it until you are killed. That's hard enough for somebody who loves life, the nature of man. But also, fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah, yani heart of sincerity, yani give me the sword, Abu Dujana. That's confidence to radiallahu anhu warda. I'm going to fight with the sword. I'm going to die beneath the sword. And my heart, lillah, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so it was for Sayyidina Abu Dujana. Remember, that's third year after what? After Hijrah. We're going to see Abu Dujana radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, the battle of Yamama, when they can't get inside of the actual what? Garden of death. What does Abu Dujana radiallahu anhu warda say? Just throw me over the wall. Take me and catapult me over the wall. Fearless. Why? Because he knows he has to die with the sword, and you know he was packed with that sword upon his back, radiallahu anhu warda, over the wall, breaks his leg upon landing, radiallahu anhu warda, stumbles somehow to the door, opens up the door of the wall of the actual garden where Banu Hanifa have taken refuge in, and then the Sahaba all enter. When they all enter, lock the door, just lock the door. They locked the door of the fortress, took the key, Sahaba throw it out of the garden. I mean, it's death inside of them. That's what's called the garden of death. Then they go to battle. And what do we note when Musaylima is killed? Of those who it said who kills Musaylima is Sayyidina Abu Dujana. Simak ibn Kharasha radiallahu anhu warda. When Wahshi said, I don't know who killed him. Was it my spear? Or was it the sword that hit him? Of the Ansari, in one riwayah that he says, they dispute who the sword was. And of them who said it was the sword of Abu Dujana. But that's where he's going to die, right in the midst of the garden of death. Sayyidina Abu Dujana radiallahu anhu warda. And look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhu warda, you know, on your death, mashallah, I made it, I'm dying beneath. And when they ask him, what is it that you enjoy about life? Is there anything you remember of life? And Sayyidina Abu Dujana, as he's dying in the battle of death, in the garden of death, he said, I remember about life, and I take to my grave, I never got involved in anything that wasn't any of my business. Because the Prophet of the good of somebody's Islam is they keep out of that which is none of their business. Sahaba said, were you to spend your entire life speaking as ulama, said, were you to spend your entire life speaking about that one tradition, yani khalas, you wouldn't exhaust its meanings. That one tradition from the good of somebody's Islam, they keep out of that which is none of their business. That's what he's saying upon his deathbed, radiallahu anhu warda, Abu Dujana. Yani As-Sa'id ibn Uthman ibn Mad'un. It's the son of the great Uthman ibn Mad'un. Uthman ibn Mad'un, the first one to be buried in Bakir, the old friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of the very early Muslims, one who makes hijrah, hijratain, hijrah to Habasha, to Abyssinia, and likewise hijrah to Medina, to Munawwara. First one to die in Medina, and to be buried in the supreme graveyard of Bakir. This is his son, As-Sa'id, dies in the Battle of Yamama. As-Sa'id ibn al-Awam, who's that? The brother of the great Zubayr. Sayyidina Zubayr's full brother, same father, same mother, i.e. his mother is the great Safiya, the aunt of the Prophet ﷺ, dies in the Battle of Yamama. Dirar ibn al-Aswad al-Asadi, the bare-chested warrior, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, the opinion that he dies here, inside of the Battle of Death, the one who would go to battle, bare-chested, Sayyidina Dirar radiallahu anhu warda, not fear, not taken the normal means of protection somebody would take when they go to battle. The brother of the great Khawla bint al-Azwar, one of the other great warriors of Ahlul Islam, Tufail bin Amr al-Dawsi, who is that? Imam of Yemen. It's as if he's the first Yemeni to become Muslim. He's the one when the Prophet tells him, leave Mecca, it's unsafe for you, go and call your people Dawsi to actually Islam. And then he goes through the desert, he asks the Prophet ﷺ, give me a sign by which people can recognize that I'm truthful and what I took from you. And then as he heads towards the Yemen and he approaches the city that he's from, which is called Zabid, where Dawes used to live, that he says that on a moonless night, my face lit up, began to light up with light, so I could guide myself through the darkness of the desert, based upon what? The light, the nur Allah Ta'ala placed in my face. And he says, as I approach my city of Zabid, I can see the city of Zabid, that he says, at that point I pray to Allah Ta'ala, not in my face, Ya Allah. Take it out of my face. People don't understand that type of nur. They consider me to be a freak. Like if any of us saw somebody walk into the madrasa, nur ala nur. And their face is beaming with light. How man, you think he was a freak? You start calling 999, get a doctor here to come and see to my man. That's what he said, radiallahu anhu warda, not in my face. And then what did Allah Ta'ala then do? Took it from the face of Tufayl bin Amr al-Dawsi and places it in his staff. And then his staff becomes illumined and he guides himself through. And no wonder when he gets to Dawsi, father becomes Muslim and his mother becomes Muslim, but the rest of Dawsi refused, the great dawah of the great Imam. He's the first of them. Abad bin Bishr al-Ansari, Imam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, warda, the companions of the Messenger of Allah, bodyguards of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of those who protect the frontiers of Islam, Sayyidina Abad, the one who would find leather inside of Islam. We made mention of him in our chronicle that Sayyidina Abad is of those who was shot whilst protecting the frontiers of Islam on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he's in the midst of salah and he's just, mashallah, inside a prayer, and his fellow companion is sleeping, and the blood of Sayyidina Abad begins to drip and drip and drip, and then it begins to crawl all the way to his companion, and the companion wakes up because he feels something cool upon him, and then he just sees blood, and he just sees Abad bin Bishr inside of Salah. Let it out of luck, he's been shot by arrows, this believer is shooting at him, he doesn't move outside of prayer. Okay, this is where he meets his Lord, radiallahu anhu wada, Abad bin Bishr, Imam. He's the forefather of the great family inside of Tareem called the Khatibs. All the Khatibs who inside of Tareem, their forefather is Sayyidina Abad ibn Bishr, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wada. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, Imam. Who's his father? The chief of the Munafiqun. Munafiqun Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, this is the son Abdullah. And he's of all those who went to the Prophet for permission to kill his own father. Because his father was the head of the Munafiqun inside of Medina to Al-Munawwara. And he asked the Prophet, give me permission to actually kill my own father. To which the Prophet refused. What will they say? That Muhammad kills his companions? Look at the embracing nature of the Prophet. He's calling a munafiq, a hypocrite. Disbelieves in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of their heart, he's still calling them companions sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're all embracing the nature of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Qum andi ya Umar. And Umar ibn Khattab is trying to stop the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from praying over Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. Ya munafiq ya Rasulullah. He's grabbing the actual rida, the garment of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Qum andi, leave me alone ya Umar. Pray over him. And he says, O Messenger of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even if you seek forgiveness for them 70 times, that they will not be forgiven, then I'll seek forgiveness 70 times, more than 70. The Prophet says, I'm munafiq. Somebody, look what he did to you, O Messenger of Allah, in Baghdad. O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look what he did to you in Uhud. O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look what he did inside of Khandaq, beautiful awra, that our houses are exposed. O Messenger of Allah, look what he did to you in Hudaybiyah. You can mention all of the treachery of Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. Yet the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, embraces the treacherous. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul even knew he was true. In his will, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, I want to be buried in the shirt of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look, even a munafiq wants to yatabarrak bin Nabi, wants to take the barakah of the Prophet ﷺ, a munafiq. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, and how does the Messenger embraces him? Gives him his shirt. He's buried in the shirt of the Messenger of God, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. This is the great son, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, who likewise is killed at the Battle of Yamana. Abdullah ibn Atiq, of the assassins of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone who killed on behalf assassinations with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa, Yazid bin Thabit, who is that, the brother of the great Zayd ibn Thabit, who we discussed inside of today's class, also likewise killed. What is the point? If you were to look at all of those who were killed inside of Yamama, there is a common theme. Those who are versed in deen are dying. And when we mean versed in deen, they are the ones who the Quran has been placed inside of their breast. And that is going to force Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu warda to now petition Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. We've got to bring it out of sudur into sutur. We've got to bring the Quran out of the breasts of men and place it upon the pages of books. Out of fear that if the men die, the Quran goes. Yani, we, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna lahu lahafidhun. Allah says, we will protect the Quran. That's important. You could ask Umar ibn Khattab, Ya Umar, afala tu'min? Don't you believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect the Quran, preserve the Quran? Bala, of course I agree, but I want to be the one he preserves the Quran upon. I want to expose myself to that nafha. I want to expose myself to that diffusion that Allah ta'ala preserves the Quran due to me being of those who engages the means in order to see the Quran in and of itself preserved. That's the rationale of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu warda. So this is one of the great things that we see in the life and times of Abu Bakr, very important. This now, the Quran is being brought together into what is termed the Mus'haf, the scripture. This is the bringing together of the Quran into one Mus'haf. Okay? On the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, who said, the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not write on my authority. Whoever writes on my authority other than the Quran, then let them erase it. The Prophet ﷺ said, however, narrate as you please, orally, on my authority, but whoever lies intentionally about me, then let them prepare their seat in hell. The Prophet ﷺ said, and that's a very fundamental tradition inside of what our religion in and of itself. The first is what we see, that the only thing the companions are being encouraged upon the commandment of the Prophet ﷺ to do in terms of writing and recording is to write and record the Quran. Everything else left. And then this is going to, you can see, continued in the life of Abu Bakr and especially in the life of Umar ibn Khattab, where they're going to be very, very averse to anybody writing down any words, even the words of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ himself. And the great fear now, because this is the age of the preservation of the Quran in and of itself, and the fear was that the words of men, or of man, even the supreme man, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, could become intermingled with the Quran in and of itself. So that we see it radicalized in the age of Umar ibn Khattab. As we will say, Umar ibn Khattab would put you in jail, imprison you, if he saw you relating a hadith. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab. No, this is the age of the preservation of Quran. And until that project is completed, which is going to be in the third vicegerency, that of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, yani be careful in that regard. So this is the first instruction is the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And don't even write my words, narrate them. Convey. Bellow anni, wallah ayah, and convey on my behalf even a verse of the Quran, convey on my behalf even any words the Prophet ﷺ says, let those who are present, yani warn or inform those who are absent. We'll hear the Prophet ﷺ speak about this, but that's orally. But as for in the case of doing it in writing, la, only the Quran can be written. One of the points we take from that is that the Quran is recorded in the life and times of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ. It's not just in the breasts of men. It's not just in memory. They've also recorded the Quran in writing. And that's one of the things they're going to see now in the actual house of the Prophet ﷺ himself. They're going to find after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, a lot of parchments of the Quran in and of itself. And that's one of the first things that they do is they gather together all those parchments of the Quran and then they're going to deliver it to the great compiler, who's saying Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Al-Ansari. Be careful of messing with the Quran and be careful of messing with the words of the Prophet ﷺ. Both come through him. And that's why he says at the end of the hadith, yani, whoever intentionally lies about me, then let them prepare their seat in hell. That hadith, that part of tradition, is also in Sahih al-Bukhari. And that is the soundest hadith in existence. There's no hadith that is more sound than that tradition. And if that is the tradition, the Sahaba rushed, Atba Tabi'in rushed, to preserve in great numbers. Whoever man kadhaba alayya muta'ammidan, fayatabaw maq'adahu minan nar. That whoever what intentionally lies about me, then let them prepare their seat in hell. On the authority of Zayd ibn Thabit, who said the Quran had not been gathered in anything upon the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahibu sallam. And what does it mean it not being gathered, the entire Quran gathered together as one book, as one mushaf, as one scripture? It was mutafarriqa. Somebody would have X amount of parchments, they took the one X amount of parchments, this one the entire Quran committed to memory, four of the companions radiallahu anhu warda. But you'd find no single person with the entire Quran inside of one thing that would later be called the mushaf. That's what Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu is referring to upon the death of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Hakim al-Naysaburi, he makes mention that the Quran was gathered upon three occasions. Three times we're going to see the entire Quran gathered. When is the first? In the time of the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa. We note what he means here. And this once again is related to the authority of Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, the great companion al-Ansari. We said we used to compile the Quran upon animal skins in the presence of the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sahibu wa sallam. That's the point. And then the end part of the hadith, when he suddenly remarked sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Tuba Lisham. We should always remember those words, especially in these difficult days that Sham is experiencing right now. The Levant, Syria and its likes, Palestine and its likes, Lebanon and its likes. These difficult days and the difficult days for Sham and the people of Sham. Yet the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has guaranteed them glad tidings. Tuba Lisham. We ask, and why may that be? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, because the angels of the Beneficent have spread their wings over it. The Prophet said, an extremely blessed place, Northern Arabia. The second time it was gathered, which is more so our dars, is in the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. And this is the point for those here, on the authority of Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhu, who said, Abu Bakr sent for me after the killings that occurred at Yamama, and there stood Umar ibn al-Khattab alongside him. Abu Bakr thereby said, verily Umar came unto me and said, verily a great number of those versed in the Quran have been killed, martyred, and I truly fear that even more of those versed will be killed in other places, because these are the armies that have gone out to the four corners of Arabia, such that a great portion of the Quran will be lost. I therefore think that you should command the compilation of the Quran. That's Umar ibn Khattab speaking to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. What's Abu Bakr as-Siddiq anhu's reply? So I said to Umar, how can I do something that the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never did? Note, that's his first response. And we know that Abu Bakr, radicalness upon the Sunnah. As we mentioned in our previous class, even when Sahaba, including Umar, are trying to convince Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda to remove Sayyidina Usama ibn Zayd from being the leader of the army that goes out to face Rome. And you want me to change something that Prophet ﷺ himself commanded? Abadan, never. You dare speak to me? Umar came out sweating. Umar ibn al-Khattab. After what being what rebuked by Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and thereby rebukes the Ansar. The Ansar would put Umar ibn al-Khattab up to that. Radical upon the Sunnah. How can I do something the Messenger of God ﷺ never did? What does Umar say? By God, it's good. Huwa wallahi khair. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Makes a note. And he continually repeated this to me until God opened up my heart to it, and I thereby was of the same opinion as Umar. And Umar convinces Abu Bakr now to bring the Quran together into sort of one edition. Zayd said, Abu Bakr said, verily you are a young, intelligent man. Young and intelligent man. Whom we find no fault in. Let me tell him up. Find no fault in you whatsoever. You used to write revelation on behalf of the Messenger of God, an official prophetic scribe. So go in search of the Quran and compile it. Zayd says, by God, had they entrusted me with moving one of the mountains, it would have been easier for me than this commandment of compiling the Quran. I said, how can both of you do something that the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa never did? In another riwayah, how can I do something that the Messenger of God sallallahu never did? What was Abu Bakr's reply? The same reply as Umar ibn Khattab. By God, it's good, it's good. Brothers all from the same source. Abu Bakr continued repeated this to me until God opened up my heart to that which he opened up the heart of Abu Bakr and Umar. I thereby began to collate the Quran He sets about with this sort of arduous and great amana of now collecting the entire Quran, compiling it from date palm branches, stone etchings, and the breasts of men. And I found that only Abu Khuzaymah al-Ansari, his name is Abu Khuzaymah, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit al-Ansari radiallahu anhu, had memorized the end of the chapter of the repentance. Yani, there has come unto you, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ. Yani, there has come unto you a messenger from amongst yourselves. It weighs heavily on him that you be ruined. He is anxious for you, compassionate and merciful to the believers. But if they turn away, then say, God is sufficient for me. There is no other deity. It is in God that I put my trust as Lord of the tremendous throne. And he found that only that verse alone was with one of the companions whose name is Abu Khuzaymah, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit al-Ansari, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. What he alluded to, Sayyid Zayd, radiallahu anhu warda, is that what the Quran, every verse of the Quran needed two witnesses to affirm that it was from the Quran. Two verses. So every single verse in the Quran, he found two witnesses. This is from the Quran, this is from the Quran. We bore witness to that, every single verse. Except when it comes to this verse. And likewise, in another riwayah, some say relates to the time of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, okay, is one, it's the same in Khuzaymah ibn Thabir, is the verse, من المؤمنين الرجال صدقوا ما عهد الله عليه, Surah Al-Ahzab, found that it was only with Sayyidina Thabit ibn Khuzaymah ibn Thabir, radiallahu anhu warda. Only person, one witness, he says, we need another witness, and they say, not for this man. He said, what do you mean, not for this man? This is the one who the Prophet ﷺ said, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit is two of you in terms of witnessing. See, look at that. Look how Allah Ta'ala preserved it. That verse with somebody who equals two witnesses. To show you how great he is in that regard, Umar ibn al-Khattab came with a verse in the Quran. It's called Ayat al-Rajm. And in the Sheikha, a mature man or a married man and a married woman who commit adultery, stone them. It's the verse of stoning that was abrogated, lafzan. It was in the Quran, taken out of the Quran, lafzan, but the hukm remains. The judgment of any of an adulterer is to be stoned to death. That was a verse actually in the Quran. Umar actually brings that verse. Yani Zayd, what refuses the verse? Bring me somebody else who confirms it's in the Quran, in the last revision of the Prophet ﷺ and Gabriel. Umar can't bring anybody else. They send Umar ibn Khattab away. Umar, away. But he accepts saying the Khuzaymah ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu warda. Why? Because he bore witness to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In some that you may consider to be menial. And why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bought from one of these Bedou, these Arabs, he bought a horse sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to pay him the money for the horse. And then this Arab, then he bought the horse sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All he's going to do is pay the money for the horse. And then the Arab is like going around trying to get a better price. And he seems like he's got a better price than the price the Prophet ﷺ is offering. What price is better than money that comes from the Messenger of Allah? And the Arabs, and they should go for a nifaq, severe ingratitude, disbelief, and hypocrisy. So here, like this Arab now, that he's going around saying, I want a better price, and he's shouting at the Messenger of Allah, I'm going to get a better price than this. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, I bought the horse from you, it's a done deal. And he said, you haven't bought no horse? And the Prophet said, I bought a horse. He said, you better bring me a witness. And then the Prophet said, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit. Khuzaymah ibn Thabit comes forth and says, yeah, I witnessed that you bought that of that the Prophet, that you bought that of him, O Rasulullah. And the Prophet says, how are you bearing witness to that? He said, I'm bearing witness to the fact that you're truthful. The fact that you're telling the truth, it's got to be true that you bought it of him. Like, it was an actual witness. And the Prophet says, Khuzaymah is the equal of two of yous in a court of law as a witness. Just that incident renders Khuzaymah elite, radiallahu ta'ala, as a witness in the court of law, as a witness in the Quran. Anytime you recite that verse, that's one of the verses that they place inside of the Mawalid, the Mawlid. You're always reciting that verse over and over again. Remember the great Imam, radiallahu ta'ala, Khuzaymah ibn Thabit, radiallahu ta'ala, warda, affirmed inside of the Quran with the witness of one man. The scriptures thereby remained with Abu Bakr until God took him unto him, i.e. until he died. Thereafter they remained in Umar ibn al-Khattab during his lifetime, and thereafter with the great Hafsa, the daughter of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anha wa an abiha. Okay, and it's from Hafsa that Uthman ibn Affan is going to take the actual Mus'haf in the third compilation. On the authority of Abd Khair, I heard Ali radiallahu anhu say The greatest reward bestowed upon people from the scriptures is reserved for Abu Bakr and Umar. May the mercy of God be upon Abu Bakr. He was the first one to compile the Quran. Sayyidina Abu Bakr in the public sense, although the likes of Ibn Juzay al-Kalibi, rahimahullah ta'ala al-Gharnati, in his great work of Tashil fi Ulum al-Tanzil, the facilitation as it relates to the sciences of the Quran, he relates that the actual first one to compile the entire Quran was man, was whom? Ali ibn Abi Talib. That was the position of the great Imam of Muslim Spain, Ibn Juzay radiallahu anhu al-Maliki. That was actually Ali ibn Abi Talib. He mentions two things. That first, that Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu warda, it's well known that he made an oath. We spoke before of why did Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib yani refrain, quote unquote, in the apparent sense, from taking bay'ah with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. There's a riwayah that Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib made an oath upon the death of the Prophet ﷺ. I am not going to leave my house. Made an oath. Not going to leave my house except for Salah until I've compiled the entire Quran. The actual entire Quran. And he just remains inside of his house, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, bringing the entire Quran together, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Until people go to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and tell Abu Bakr 6 months later, Ali radiallahu anhu ma kharaj wa ma bay'ak. Ali has not left and he's not giving you bay'ak. Maybe Ali is sort of averse to you in some way or another. And so in the riwayah, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu goes to Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Abu Bakr goes to Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib and asks him, why isn't it you given bay'ak? Why have you not left your house? And Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib tells him the reason. I made an oath to Allah ta'ala that I would not leave my house until I brought the entire Quran together. And he did do it, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. And Abu Bakr radiya bihi. Abu Bakr, mashallah, was pleased with the excuse that Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu gave him. That was not a riwayah that we see. But you see, Ali was the first one to actually compile the entire Quran. And there's some uniquenesses about the actual mushaf of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. One of them, Ali ibn Abi Talib compiles the entire Quran in what we call revealed order. Revealed order. And there's two things that the race of the Quran is what we call revealed order and what we call order revealed. Opposite. You can call it revealed order and order revealed. Revealed order means how each and every single verse come down. The chronological nature of revelation. What verses or chapters came down first, second, third, like Surah Al-Alaq, Surah Al-Mudathir, Surah Al-Muzammil, Surah Al-Duha, etc. All the orders to the last Surah revealed into Surah Al-Idha Jaa Nasrullahi Wal Fath, on opinions, last ayahs revealed in the end of Surah Al-Baqarah. Okay, so that's what you call what? Revealed order. And they say that was the nature of the Mus'haf of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Were you to see the Mus'haf of Ali, you would know exactly how each and every single verse came down. The exact order. It's amazing. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib would say, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud would say, these two great companions would say, there's not a single verse in the Quran saying that I know when it was revealed, why it was revealed, where it was revealed. Every single verse in the Quran, these two imams would say of the companions. Imam Ibn Juzay radiallahu anhu warda, he said, would that Mus'haf have still been with us? In it would have been amazing knowledge. Just to see how each and every single verse came down. And if we had the actual Mus'haf of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Likewise, the peculiarities of the actual Mus'haf of Ali ibn Abi Talib, he didn't put it in Surah Al-Falaq or Surah Al-Nas. They're not inside of the Mus'haf of Sayyidina Ali, they say. The ulama yastashkil, yani, why is this? Why didn't Ali put it inside of the Mus'haf? Yani, it, meaning, does Ali believe it's not even from the Quran? And most of them say that when Ali ibn Abi Talib saw them as, that's what they explain, that he saw them as so common upon the tongue of the believers that he had no need to put it inside of the Mus'haf. But it is from the Mus'haf. And it's Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas in of itself. So Ali ibn Abi Talib is saying here though, in terms of the public sense, who is the first one to compile the actual Mus'haf? It's whom? Abu Bakr. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, and also Umar ibn Khattab shares in that reward because he's the one who prompts Abu Bakr to do this. Radiallahu anhu warda. And then the third is we see in the third confirmation, which we'll deal with obviously later when we reach the lifetimes of the third caliph, Hussein Uthman ibn Affan. And obviously that's going to be the final confirmation of the Quran in and of itself. That is what we would call the standard edition of the Quran in and of itself. And obviously there's going to be discussion about what is the difference between the actual Mus'haf as compiled by Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu warda under the great Imam Sayyidina Zayd bin Thabit and the one compiled by Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, notably under the same Imam Zayd bin Thabit said that one thing Uthman ibn Affan does, which is very important, he places alongside Sayyidina Zayd three great companions, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Sayyidina Sa'id ibn al-As, and ibn Haritha. He placed like three companions, Qurayshi, alongside the great Ansari Zayd. Why? Because the issue of Sayyidina Uthman, the standard edition which we all now recite in accordance to, it's Qurayshi. And the standard, it has to be in the language of Quraysh. Sayyidina whom? Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wa arda la. Abu Bakr compiled the entire Quran in all of its manifestations. Sab'at al-Ahruf, the seven variant manifestations of the Quran in al-Bukhari. Inna al-Quran unzila ala sab'ati ahruf. The Quran has been revealed in seven letters. There are over 45 different opinions about what does that hadith mean. What are the seven letters of the Quran? Yani whatever it means, okay? And some say the strongest is the seven letters of the seven supreme dialects of the Arabs in and of themselves. Some say that's the strongest opinion. The Quran was revealed in the seven supreme dialects of Arabia. And Abu Bakr compiles all of that into one compilation. He's got to call it something, so what do we call it? Abu Bakr then takes from the Abyssinians. He was told that what? That the Abyssinians, that when they bring their scripture together, they call it a mushaf. The Abyssinians. And obviously, Abyssinian has a great effect upon Medini life because the Sahaba lived like a decade, 15 years, saying that Ja'far and others lived inside of Abyssinia. And so then, what? Abu Bakr, Radi, he accepts that word, and this becomes the mushaf. That's how you get the name, the mushaf. And then we hear the great daughter of Abu Bakr, radiallahu anha, wa Allah, saying that Aisha, our mother, that she says, what? Ma bayna defatay al mushaf kalamullah. That which is between the two covers of the mushaf is the word of God, the literal word of God, okay? The Quran. So that's the third compilation. We have to make mention of the Imam, because obviously all of us are indebted to him. The great Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. This is the Imam, the one who actually compiles the Quran, who's in charge by both caliphs, Abu Bakr and Uthman, to actually compile the Quran. Yani this is an Imam towering in terms of knowledge. Then when we look at who are the great Imams of the companions, in terms of intellect, no doubt whatsoever, he's from amongst them. And then you see who are the ones who are really exemplary. We'll mention the likes of whom? Umar ibn al-Khattab. But we'd mention more than Umar, Ali ibn Abi Talib. We'd mention more than Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. We'd mention like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Zayd ibn Thabit. We'd mention like Zayd ibn Thabit, Aisha, yeah, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In that they are the companions who it said were the most knowledgeable of all. Okay, if you take the traditions, who is the most knowledgeable companions? You'll hear Ali ibn Abi Talib's name mentioned. You'll hear whom? Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud mentioned. You will hear whom? Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit mentioned. You'll hear whom? Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha mentioned. And no doubt she's the great teacher Aisha. But in terms of the real towering minds of the companions, usually they focus upon three companions. Ali, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and whom? Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhu wa arda. Some of them say all knowledge returned to Zayd. That the Imam of knowledge of all the companions was Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit. And we know he's the Imam of Quran. He's the one who brings and in charge to bring the entire Quran together. Who is he? Radiallahu anhu wa arda. Maybe many of us have not heard of him. He is Abu Sa'id Zayd ibn Thabit ibn al-Dahhaq, ibn Zayd ibn Ludhan, ibn Amr ibn Abd Auf, ibn Ghanab ibn Malik ibn al-Najjar, ibn Fa'alaba al-Khazraji al-Ansari, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. A neighbor of the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lived a few doors away from the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very young. When he enters into Islam, he's like tender in age, like 11 years of age, radiallahu anhu warda. He's not even old enough, strong enough to fight in battle. He's trying to go to Uhud. The Prophet sends him away, you're too young, you can't even go to battle. Then the Prophet notices something blessed inside of Zayd. That this is a man who has a heart that can embrace knowledge. And then the Prophet then what tells him to go and seek, to seek knowledge, focus upon knowledge. And in particular language, as we see Sayyidina Zayd radiallahu anhu warda, in a tradition, look at his tradition, on the authority of Thabit ibn Zayd, the son of Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, Thabit ibn Zayd, who says, the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me, have you mastered Syriac, Suryani? I replied, no. He's young, he's only like 11, 12 years of age. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then learn it, go and learn it. I thereby learned it in 17 days. 17 days learned the entire language of Suryani. 17 days, that's Allah salam al-afiyya. Why did the Prophet want him to learn another tradition? Because of what? It's the language of the Jews. That's what the Jews spoke in Medina. They never spoke Hebrew, they spoke Suryani. Syriac, which is one of the highest languages. It's a language which is from the same sort of family tree as the Arabic language, okay? But it's what? It's considered by Ahlul Islam to be the language one of the angels. The Malaika speaks Suryani. And likewise, also the language of the ruh of the soul in and of itself. Our soul speaks Suryani. And third is the language of the Barzakh. Inside of the interspace, that's what you speak, Suryani. And many of us, we have dreams. And then we say, I saw somebody in a dream and they were speaking. And it was a language which was like Arabic. Like Arabic. The element of dream interpretation say more likely they were speaking Suryani. Because that's a language of spirit, souls, and that's what one of the manifestations of true dreams is. What is the soul's manifestation and the language of the soul in and of itself. So he was ordered by the Prophet ﷺ to learn Syriac, a very important language. The entire script of the Quran, Uthman's original script is in Syriac. Arabic letters are from Syriac. The entire Quran, from beginning to end, concurs with Syriac in terms of rules. The entire Quran from beginning to end, note, and please note, underline, does not conform with the Arabic language. It has its own rules. Remember, the Quran has its own rules in terms of orthography, in terms of the script, in Arabic. In Syriac, no. It's perfect in Syriani. And that shows the khitab of the word, the Quran in and of itself. Alami speaks to body and soul, the Quran in and of itself. And powerful, mashallah, tabarakallah, the sirs, the asrar of the Quran in and of itself. Okay? Zayd mastered it, but part of the reason, because of the success of the Jews, that the Jews may tamper with the Quran. So know it, so that you can refute and keep the Jews at bay. The Prophet said to Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit. Anas in al-Bukhari, he says, four companions memorized the entire Quran during the lifetime of the Messenger of God. All of them being from the helpers, all Ansari, not a single Meccan memorized the entire Quran from beginning to end. Every one of them were Medini. Some say four, some say eight. This tradition, four. All of them being from the helpers, whom? Ubay ibn Ka'ab, the great Imam of Medina, Aqra, of whom, as the Prophet said, the one who is what? Who is most versed in the Quran in terms of recitation. The first one to recite, to lead Taraweeh for Ahlul Islam, saying Nawas, saying Ubay ibn Ka'ab. He's the one in the famous hadith in al-Bukhari that when he's saying Umar ibn al-Khattab Ubay ibn Ka'ab, he sees a man reciting the Quran, and then he sort of notices that the way he's reciting the Quran differs from the way the Prophet taught him. So saying Ubay radiallahu anhu, so that's going to snatch this man out of prayer, but out of what respect for prayer, khalas, I let him be. When the man finishes, I say, where did you learn that from? He says, the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no, you didn't. Because I learned it in a different way. He said, halumma, let's go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They go to the Messenger of Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, recite, O Ubay. And then Ubay recites the Quran. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hekada unzil. This is how it's revealed. And then he asks the man, recite the Quran. And then the man recites, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hekada unzil. This is how it was revealed. Inna al-Qur'an unzil ala sabati ahru. The Quran was revealed in seven what? Seven letters. Ubay, you see, kayfa man tu deen tu dan. As you treat, you will be treated. So you see a man in prayer reciting the Quran. Why did I learn it that way? You want to disturb his prayer, but you don't out of respect for the prayer. You treat someone that way. What goes around comes around. So now Ubay is in prayer, reciting, and who comes? Quote unquote, your worst nightmare, Umar ibn al-Khattab. Comes and Umar ibn al-Khattab, he hears him reciting the Quran. Umar says, I want to snatch him out of prayer. Snatch him out of prayer. But out of my respect for prayer, I let him be. Then Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he finishes praying, he grabs Ubay, says, where did you learn this from? Ubay said, Min Rasulillah, from the Messenger of Allah. He said, no. I learned it from the Messenger of Allah in a different way. Let's go to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Umar ibn al-Khattab, Iqra ya Umar. Umar recites the Quran, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hakaba unzil. This is how it is revealed. Ubay recite the Quran. And then Ubay radiallahu anhu recites the Quran, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, hakaba unzil. This is how it is revealed. Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu anhu, at that point, he's like, what's going on here? Revealed in all these different ways, What does he say? Look at the truthfulness of the Sahaba. Shakaktu fil Rasulillah shak al jahiliyah. I had doubt in the Messenger of God, the same doubt we had in the days of ignorance. Is he the Messenger of God? That's the type of doubt that then afflicts my heart. Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu wa radahu says, Alhamdulillah, he has Tabib al-Azam. He has the Prophet and the Supreme Doctor in front of him. The season to the heart of Ubay takes his hand, boom, smacks the heart of Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b. He said, all the doubt, poof, flew out. Firm upon the deen. This is Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b. He's the first one to lead Taraweeh. By Umar ibn Khattab. Look at Umar, the one who's going to snatch out of prayer, he snatched into prayer. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab snatches Ubay when he sees in his khilaf and everybody praying Taraweeh by themselves. And Umar ibn Khattab says, wouldn't it be a good thing if everyone prayed behind one imam? He said, tomorrow, mur Ubay ibn Ka'b. Command Ubay ibn Ka'b to lead the prayer inside of the masjid, lead the people inside of Taraweeh. Next night, Umar comes and he finds them what, all praying behind Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b. And Umar ibn Khattab says, what a great bid'ah this is. That's the weight of Umar. A great bid'ah this is, all praying behind the great Imam Ubay ibn Ka'b. From amongst them, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Imam, the mountain of the companions. Likewise, some consider the most knowledgeable hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as we've seen. Zayd ibn Thabit, the one we were looking at, and Abu Zayd, also four companions who memorized the entire Quran, yani during the life and times of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. One may ask, well, what about the rest? Where are the great Imams? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Zayd, Talha. Why haven't they memorized the entire Quran? Fear of the Quran in and of itself. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud himself, what explains it? That what us, the people of Mecca in particular, us, Medinis followed them, that we would take 10 verses of the Quran, we would learn them, memorize them, understand them, implement them, embody them, and we would not go any further till we did that. Then we would take another 10, same process. Then another 10, same process. That's what slowed them down in their acquisition of the Quran. Because Quran is a book that should be living, a living book. And in our age, as we inshallah will see at the end of this darus, that's one of the challenges of our age, to take the Quran from the sultur into sudur. Take it from the actual pages of books and place it back in the heart in the real sense, so it becomes a living, organic reality inside of the Ummah in this age of ours, this dire age. On the authority of Thabit ibn Zayd, Zayd said, the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me, in Syria. On the authority of Khalid ibn Zayd, another of the sons of Zayd ibn Thabit, who became one of the Imams of Medina, Fuqaha al-Medina, Sayyidina Khalid, the most knowledgeable people of the Tabi'een, the son of Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, who said that his father said the Messenger of God sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to send for me whenever revelation descended upon him, and I would thereby write it down of the scribes. And he's of those who felt the weight of the Quran. So nulqi alayka qawl hal thaqila, Allah ta'ala says, we will thrust upon you a heavy word. Once I was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his knee was resting over mine, saying that Zayd said, and then the Quran descended, revelation, and he said it is as if my knee was about to shatter due to the weight that was descending upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay? On the authority of Anas ibn Malik, the Messenger of God Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the most merciful of my nation towards my nation is Abu Bakr. Nobody's arham than Abu Bakr. The most staunch of them in relation to the commandment of God is Umar. Nobody's more staunch with the Amr of Allah, the commandment of Allah, than Umar. The most pure of them in modesty is Uthman, the one whom the angels are shy of, Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan. The most versed of them in the book of God is Ubay ibn Ka'b, the Prophet ﷺ says. The best of them in inheritance, fara'il, is ordinarily understood as inheritance, Zayd ibn Thabit, the Imam. And the most knowledgeable of them in the lawful and the unlawful is Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Every nation has a trustworthy custodian, and the trustworthy custodian of this nation is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Who are we trying to underline? Zayd ibn Thabit, Imam of Quran, Imam of what we call Fara'id, inheritance law. It's like the entire science retains back to that one Imam who studied inheritance law. It's all the madhab of Imam Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Imam of really astounding knowledge, Sayyidina Zayd. Remember, he becomes the principal teacher of whom? Of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas, we know, the great Habar, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, passing 9-10 years of age. So where does he get all his knowledge from? The kibar of the Sahaba. In particular, Umar and Zayd. They're the two greatest teachers of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas. And we know that Abdullah ibn Abbas used to camp outside the door of Zayd ibn Thabit, just outside the door sleeping. And when Sayyidina Zayd would come, there's Abdullah ibn Abbas, and would run and get the horse of Sayyidina Zayd. Abdullah ibn Abbas would say, like, what are you, Sayyidina Zayd would say, what are you doing, O cousin of the Messenger of Allah? And Abdullah ibn Abbas would say, this is how we commanded to what? To treat our teachers, our scholars. And so Zayd ibn Thabit would grab the hand of Abdullah ibn Abbas and kiss his hand. And he said, what are you doing? To Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit, he said, this is how we were commanded to treat Ahlul Bayt. And he says, Sayyidina Zayd radiallahu anhu wa rda. The adab of the Imam.